Good morning. My name is Jimmy Painter. I'm the senior pastor here at Crest Hill. And I want to tell you today two stories as we begin. Jim Smith went to church on a Sunday morning. As he sat down, he listened to the praise team take the stage, and the guitar player played the wrong chord twice. Then when everybody else was being instructed to bow their heads to pray, he looked up and looked around and he saw a teenage girl talking with her friends there in the back. Then when the offering plate came by that morning, he could have sworn that the usher was just staring at him to find out how much he put in the plate. When the final commitment song of the morning was being played, he quietly slipped out a side door and he said to himself, "What a bunch of hypocrites. I'm never going back to that place." Let me tell you another story. Ron Jones went to church on a Sunday morning, and as he sat down, he heard the praise team lift up the name of Jesus in a way that just moved his soul. There was a young girl that stood up that morning and told a story, a simple story about how her faith in Jesus sustains her and got her through, made all the difference in her life. He was moved that they were taking a special offering that morning so that they could feed hungry children in Nigeria. And then when the pastor preached that morning, he was so glad that he was there because he spoke and God used him to speak to areas of his life where he had had some significant questions. And at the close of the service, as he walked out of the door, he said to himself, "How could anyone come here and not feel the presence of God?" Both men went to the same church on the same morning. How is it possible for two men to attend the same church, the same service on the same morning, and get two totally different things out of the experience? I'll tell you how. What made the difference between these two guys was a single word called attitude. Attitude. It's all about attitude. Attitude is everything when it comes to living out our God-given destiny. And truth be told, if we could all just be honest for just a moment, there are a lot of us that need to take a checkup from the neck up, and we need an attitude adjustment. So if that's you today, wherever you're watching this around the world, if your prayer today would be, "Dear God, I need an attitude adjustment," I've got great news for you. Dr. Jesus is about to make a house call. Today I want to direct your attention to one passage in the Bible that speaks to adjusting our attitudes in a godly way. That text is 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 9 through 11. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, beginning with the 9th verse. The Apostle Paul, out of his own experience, in one of his moments of greatest transparency, shares the following. He writes, "For I am the least of the apostles, unworthy to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace toward me was not in vain. On the contrary, I worked harder than any of them, though it was not I, but the grace of God that is within me. Whether then it was I or they, so we preach, and so you believed. Paul possessed a particular mindset, let's call it that, an attitude that we would be wise to emulate. Paul's attitude included, watch this, humility. That was the first characteristic of Paul's attitude. Here in today's text, we read the writings of a man whom God had humbled, a man whom was humbled himself before God. In verse 9 of 1 Corinthians chapter 15, he tells us, "For I am the least of the apostles," the least of that inner group that had been with Jesus. Now, there are some of us who have some semblance of biblical knowledge or a depth of theological understanding. And we read that and we think, well, Paul, you're just being humble. That, or perhaps it's even false humility. But I would say unto you, I think not. Paul believed this to be true to the very core of his being, that among all of those first apostles of Jesus, that he was indeed the very least. Here he goes on to say, "I do not even desire to be called an apostle." Why would he say such a thing? Here's why. Paul says, "I persecuted the church of God." And as you read the story, that's true. That's who he was. He was a persecutor of the early church. Paul had done just that, and you can read all about it in the book of Acts. From him holding the coats of those who stoned Stephen in Acts chapter 7, verse 58, and Acts chapter 8, verse 1, to Paul's being zealously consumed with destroying the church of Jesus Christ in its infancy. Acts chapter 8, verse 3 says, "But Saul was ravaging the church and entering house after house. He dragged off men and women and committed them to prison." This is his story. And while Jesus had saved him and delivered him from that, he never forgot it. Hear me now. Allow God to use your scars to anoint you and take you places you could have never gotten to otherwise. Paul did that. Paul never forgot who he was, and he never forgot what he had done. And hear me, please. It was not guilt that he carried. He had been delivered from all of that. But rather, what he had was a deep, abiding understanding of his actions and the consequences of those actions. And this realization brought forth a Christ-like, God-honoring attitude of humility. That word humility comes from a Greek word, hupotasso, that literally means to place yourself under another. It's very closely connected to the word submit or submission. It means that you understand your identity, even though you're understanding your destiny, and you understand all of that, but it is a bowing down. It is an understanding of looking at yourself through not your own lenses, nor the eyes of others, but rather to see yourself as God sees you. So the question comes, after understanding what I just said, you may still be sitting there saying, "Well, I still don't get it. What exactly is humility?" Keith Brooks tells us that humility does not consist of simply thinking cheaply of oneself so much as it is not thinking of oneself at all and thinking of Christ more and more. Watchman Nee writes, "Genuine humility is unconscious. God's workmen must be emptied of self so that they are unconsciously humble." Thomas Watson wrote, "Humility is like the lead in the net which keeps the soul down when it is rising through pride. And contentment is like the cork which keeps the heart up when it is sinking through discouragement." That great writer Thomas A. Kempis said, "The more humble a man is in himself and the more obedient towards God, the wiser he will be in all things and the more his soul will be at peace." Andrew Murray, that great prayer warrior of another generation, writes, "The humble man feels no jealousy or envy. He can praise God when others are preferred, when others are blessed before him. He can bear to hear others praised while he is forgotten. Why? Because he has received the Spirit of Jesus, who pleased not himself and sought not his own honor." Paul, when he met Jesus on the Damascus Road, well, it changed everything. It changed his occupation. It changed his vocation. It changed his direction. It changed his destiny. And make no mistake about it, Jesus gave Paul an attitude adjustment. And I came today to tell you, friend, that he can do the same for you. And it all begins with humility. Humility. Attitude. Let me ask you today, if you were honest with yourself, right there where you're seated, wherever you are in the world, if you were honest with yourself today and you took an appraisal of who you are and how you act, would you admit to yourself today that you need an attitude adjustment? Dare I say it, if I were to come to your home or wherever you are right now and ask the people that are closest to you, perhaps those that have been quarantined with you, what would they say? I came today to tell you that God can give you, give me, give all of us the adjustment to our attitude that we need to become all that he's declared us to be. I ask you today, would you be willing to pray a dangerous prayer? Would you be willing to pray, "Dear God, would you please give me an attitude adjustment?" If that's you, I came today to tell you, help is on his way, and his name is Jesus. Next week when we gather, we're going to discover more about the components of Paul's attitude so that we can imitate and emulate him. So until then, let's all pray, "Dear God, give me a checkup from the neck up. I need an attitude adjustment." Today, as we prepare to close our time together, and I want to thank you so much for worshiping with us today. Can I tell you that as we've shared today, in no way, shape, or form has this been a large group self-help session. This has not been a large group counseling session. Can I tell you that the things that we've talked about here today as it relates to attitude adjustment, and particularly about humility, that humanly speaking, they're absolutely impossible? To say, "I'm going to humble myself and do that as an act of the will," and think that you're going to be successful, well, I came today to tell you, unfortunately, it's just not going to happen. Say, "Well, I'm going to correct my attitude and I'm going to do better." Really? For how long? Instead of making a resolution, how about today you make a revolution? You see, in order to exercise humility and to have that a part, a genuine part of your personality, and to be reflective in your attitude, that can only happen when you die to yourself and you ask Jesus to come into your heart. You see, humanly possible, these things are impossible. But the Bible says that with Jesus, all things are possible. Not only can Jesus give you an attitude adjustment, not only can he place humility into your heart and let that show forth in your life, But it all comes from the transformation that happens within your own heart and your own life when you ask this great big old God to come and set up residence right in here. It's when you say, I can't do this on my own. Nobody else can do this for me but you. Help, Jesus, I need you. So for you, if that is your prayer, I want to invite you right now to ask Jesus to come into your heart. Oh, I'm not talking about religion. I'm not talking about joining a church. I'm not talking about going through the rites or the rituals of religion like catechism or baptism or confirmation. I'm not talking about any of that. What I'm talking about today is a personal relationship with God by receiving Jesus Christ as your Savior. Let me ask you right now. Has there ever been a time in your life where you asked Jesus to come into your heart? A conscious time in your life where you realized who you were and what you were and how you could never get to where you needed to go all by yourself. Did you ever come to the realization of what your sins are and what they've done to you and everyone around you? That no matter how hard you've tried to straighten up your act and do better, it just doesn't work. It just doesn't, can I say this? Take. It doesn't stay. It may last for a moment. But you need more than a moment. You need eternity, don't you? I want to invite you to invite Jesus to come into your heart. You see, the Bible says that if you call on the name of the Lord Jesus, it says that in the book of Romans. That you call on Jesus saying, I believe you are who you say you are, that you did for me all of the things that you said that you did for me, where you came and you lived a perfect, sinless life. And that you went to the cross and took my place and you died a perfect death. And it wasn't your sin that you died for because you hadn't committed any. You took mine and everybody else's, past, present, and future. And then God raised you up from the grave, so that I would know that what you promised me, I would have. Not only did you die for me, but you live for me. And I want to ask you right now to come into my heart. So I want to invite you right there where you are. That sensation that you're feeling, hear me please. That's God knocking on the door of your heart. Don't ignore it. Don't get up and walk away from your electronic device. Don't turn this off. This is God calling. Right there where you are. I'll help you if you'll let me. I want to invite you to pray this prayer right now with me. But you got to mean it. Right there where you are. Would you say, Jesus? Say that. Jesus, I'm so sorry for my sins. I believe with everything within me that if I were the only person that had ever been created, ever been born, that you would have left all the glories of heaven to come down here into this world and do for me what you did. Please forgive me. I turn away from my sin. I turn away from depending on myself. I can't do it anymore. I'm sick and tired of being sick and tired, and I'm coming to you. Come into my heart. I receive you as my Savior. With your help, I'll make you the Lord of my life. I pray this in your name, Jesus. Amen. I came today to tell you that if you prayed that prayer and you really meant it, at 11:17 Eastern Standard Time, you were born again. You were saved. You were delivered from your sin. You're not in bondage to that anymore. Heaven is your home. And I want to say, welcome to the family of God. I want to help you today in this new journey. I want to provide materials for you to help you begin in your walk. You see, this isn't the end. This is the beginning, an exciting beginning. You see, you've got heaven, but you've had experienced a taste of heaven right now, right here, by receiving Jesus as your Savior. Your eternity begins today. Would you email me and tell me of your decision? I want to help you grow in this newfound faith that you have in Jesus. My email is very simple. It's painter@cresthill.org. painter@cresthill.org. That's all you need. Let me know of your decision today. I want to help you grow in your newfound walk of faith. Now, for those of you that know Jesus and have walked with Jesus and are born again and have a relationship with Jesus, but as we talk today about attitude, something struck a chord, didn't it? It's interesting that in the crucible of pressure, as Thomas Carlyle said, our truest selves are revealed. So during this COVID-19 pandemic, particularly when we've been together in settings that are out of the ordinary, shall I say, have the people around you begun to pick up on things that are not so positive about you and your attitude? Trust me, I'm in this with you. None of us have arrived. Hear me. We're not home yet. We're not in heaven. Would you be willing to say, I've seen some things in myself that I don't like, and I need an attitude adjustment. I need to return to you, O God, with a fervor and a flame. I don't know how it happened, Lord. I do remember what it was like when we began this journey. I don't know how I got here. I came to tell you that doesn't matter where you are, you can come home. You can come home today. Not only will there be an adjustment in your attitude, but there'll be an adjustment in your whole life. It can all begin again. Hear me, please. A golf club in the hands of Phil Mickelson is a beautiful thing. A golf club in my hand is nothing but an instrument whereby you can do landscaping. It's a dangerous thing. I can't do it and can't do it very well. So it's not about things, it's not about what you can or you can't do. It's about what God can do to you and for you. But the reason I tell you the golf story is this. Hear me, please. The one thing that I have learned the few times that I have golfed is there's something called a mulligan. It means a do-over. Let me ask you today, is that what you're longing for, a do-over? You're probably sitting there thinking, well, maybe I've messed up too badly. I've done too much. I've gone too far. No. We serve a great God, an awesome God, an amazing God, a mighty God that can turn your greatest tragedy into your greatest triumph. And if you'll let him, he can transform your tragedy into your ministry. But it all begins with a step. Would you be willing to come home today? I'll help you if you'll let me. Would you pray this prayer with me? Father, I'm sorry. Just repeat that wherever you are. Father, I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry that I broke your heart. I'm so sorry that I wronged you and I've wronged others. I'm so sorry, Lord, that I haven't been the clearest reflection of you to a world that needs you so badly. Please forgive me. I know I've done some things, well, you know what I've done. Please forgive me. Restore me today. I'm coming home. I'm coming home to you. Restore me, O God. Give me back the lost years and the wasted time and the missed opportunities. I'm going to make the most of it. I commit myself to you in Jesus' name. If you prayed that prayer right there where you are, wherever you are in the world, I came today to tell you that at 11:22 Eastern Standard Time, you're restored. Don't start talking about what was. You start talking about what is and what is to come. Your best days are before you. I want to help you as you grow in this walk. Oh, it's not going to just happen. It's going to take His work and your working with Him. But I'll work with you and we will too. Would you email me and let me know of your decision so we can help you in this journey? Once again, my email is very simple. It's painter@cresthill.org. That's all you need. painter@cresthill.org. Please contact me right now. Don't wait. Don't put it off. Let me know of your decision. God bless you. As we prepare to close today, I do want to speak to those of you that are partners with us in ministry. Those of you that are blessed by this ministry, hear me now. If the time of praise, the time of prayer, the time of preaching, if this has touched your heart and blessed you, even if you would say today, well, I don't even live around that church, I came today to tell you that if you're with us today, you're one of us. We need your help. I need your help. We need you first and foremost to pray. We need prayer partners to be able to not only do what we're doing, but to expand that. We have great plans on the horizon to be able to reach even more people for the Lord Jesus Christ. But we need your help also financially. You say, well, how can you ask me to give during these difficult times? God moves our hearts to give and often give sacrificially. And I'm praying that God will do that today in your heart. I know He's done it in mine. So I want to invite you to give, no matter what amount it might be, whether you're a member of our church, whether you're a partner in ministry and you live in the area, or whether you live throughout the globe. I know that there are those of you that are watching as far away as New York and as far away as Nicaragua. We have people all over the globe that are with us today. But would you help us not only to continue what we're doing, but to expand it, to touch the globe for Jesus? Would you give a love gift today? And here's how you can give it. Would you go to cresthill.org/give? cresthill.org/give. That's cresthill.org/give. God bless you. Thank you for partnering with us. And so I say unto you, until next week, God loves you. We love you. Keep the faith.